Good morning. I'd like to begin with our opening words from Vincent Silliman, who was a mentor to a generation of Unitarian Universalist ministers and well known to those who mentored me. Let religion be to us life and joy. Let it be a voice of renewing challenge to the best we have and may be. Let it be a call to general action. Let religion be to us a dissatisfaction with things that are, which bids us serve more eagerly the true and the right. Let it be the sorrow that opens for us the way of sympathy, understanding, and service to a suffering humanity. Let religion be to us the wonder and lure of that which is only partly known and understood. Let it be hope and purpose, and is discovering of opportunities to express our best through daily task. Religion uniting us with all that is admirable in human beings everywhere, holding before our eyes a prospect of the better life for humankind, which each of us may help to make actual. Years ago, I arrived at my first Unitarian Universalist congregation. It was the First Unitarian Society of Chicago, and I loved the fact that they called themselves a society and not a church or a congregation. It was a society of seekers, people striving for truth, ideals to motivate an individual, to inspire us, so that we could grow intellectually, to challenge one another in whatever beliefs we may have held, and to continue to grow. I was inspired, perhaps, by much of the reading I had done up until that point, from the ancient classics like Marcus Aurelius to Carl Sagan's work at the time, to Voltaire, to George Bernard Shaw and Mark Twain. And all these different authors and many, many more had encouraged me to break free of the chains of the past which seemed to hold me back. Many of those chains forged in the religion of my origin. And I was very happy to throw them off. And I felt, at last, I am free. Now, to understand my journey and where I was at that particular moment, you must understand that in the faith tradition where I was raised, I was encouraged to memorize certain creedal statements. And in my youthful understanding and my enthusiasm, I certainly did. And I memorized them in English and Latin, and it became a point of personal honor that I could serve this group of people, this community, and participate in worship and other activities. But then I found myself in college, and through my readings and particular delving deeper into scripture and history, I realized that I had much to be angry about, and I made no secret about that. I had one conversation with a young man who was devout, and I was a freshman in college, and he made some sort of statement about his particular religion and about how God is in control of everything. And so I countered him with about a 45-minute lecture about everything I knew about the natural sciences. When I finally paused to catch my breath 45 minutes later, he looked at me and said, "You know what your problem is? You know too much." It was at that moment that I first began to realize that not every conversation, so-called, is truly one, that sometimes it is a soliloquy and not a conversation, and that the purpose is not necessarily to educate or to convert people, but just to show off how much I actually know. Many of you know that I took a year off, and I spent a year in Ireland. And at that point, my anger was seething. I had a chip on my shoulder as big as Idaho, some said. And I had become more entranced with various authors. I was reading Camus and Sartre as best I could. And I began to really pay attention to the world and to the people I encountered in Ireland. And I will tell you that my first reaction was to scoff at them. I saw people passing by churches and crossing themselves. I saw people doing things which seemed very superstitious, and I knew how superior I was. Perhaps the height of my arrogance was when a friend of mine came from Paris, and she had been raised in a family that was traditionally Jewish, but her family had become atheists. And so I was giving her a tour of an Irish cathedral, and I used as my pointer a lit cigarette. So I was smoking in church and using my cigarette as a pointer to show her all these various interesting, fascinating facets of architecture and history. And my friend the atheist stopped me and read me the Riot Act for being so just obviously sacrilegious and so full of myself that I was acting in such a way to show how superior I thought I was to this marvelous edifice. It gave me pause, gave me something to think about, gave me something to feel about. And I began to realize that there was some truth to this. And I began to observe my behaviors and the way I spoke and what I spoke about. And I was struck by how often when someone asked me how I was, I would say, reasonably well. Because being a reasonable person was very, very important to me. And I began to pay attention to my interactions with my family and how when I would come home from college, I would go into a confessional and challenge the priest and hold him accountable for every sin committed by the church. And I realized that I had become an ass. Thus it was that a few years later, when I did enter this Unitarian church, I had been through a lot in the decades since graduating from college, and I had been humbled, if not humiliated, on a number of occasions. And my intellect and my arrogance had failed me repeatedly. And here was a new community, a building that was called the Cathedral of Democracy, and people from various walks of life who were, in many instances, much more accomplished than I was, much more intelligent, and they did not parade their intellect for others to ooh and to ah. Rather, they were banded together to work together to make a difference in their own lives as well as in the larger civilization. And they were fulfilling the call by chanting several centuries before to grow a soul. Now, there was a time when I heard quote-unquote religious language like church, like worship, like soul, like God, and my initial reaction would be to charge to the forefront and to do battle in the name of agnosticism or atheism or non-theism, whatever you might want to call it or whatever I called it at the time, and to swat down any person's arguments or ideology which I found offensive. I became quite practiced, but again, quite an ass. Within a year of discovering Unitarian Universalism, I presented myself to the Meadville Lombard Theological School and said, I would like to be a minister. And they read what I had submitted, and they could tell that even at that point, I still had a lot of things I was wrestling with that I hadn't quite let go of this chip on my shoulder. And my friends, oh my goodness, my friends, You're going into seminary? Martin, you're the most ungodly person I know. Another person said, I remember in college how much you were against religion. Did something change? And the answer, of course, was yes. Life has a funny way of molding a person's character and transforming a person, in particular through the process of humiliation and being humbled. My mantra for many years was, you fall down and you pick yourself up. You fall down again and you pick yourself up again. And so with my spirit and my mind bruised, I began a process to come to terms with spirituality. And I discovered that there were pockets of individuals who were very much as I had been, but other pockets of individuals who had seemed to have evolved and had begun to become more insightful, more compassionate, and did not shy away from such language as spirituality. And I discovered that there was a process that we were encouraged to do, which was to look at our assumptions from the past and to discover what were the straw men, the arguments that we had built up that we could easily bash and prove how victorious we were and how much smarter we were and how our particular understandings of the world were so superior. And I discovered that the caricature of religion that I had lifted up and which I successfully did battle against for several decades was in fact a caricature. And it was a great awakening. It was also a great awakening as I began to re-examine some of the writers that I was acquainted with, such as Carl Sagan. And I watched Cosmos. And I began to feel the poetry and the mystery and the wonder. And how his thoughtfulness and his insights were infused with compassion. And I began to understand that the process of growing a soul involved so much more than intellect alone. But it really called for the whole person to come front and center. Now, mind you, there are many people whose faith is in some ways a distortion of their founder's intent. Certainly in some traditions, humanity's sinful nature is front and center and is the cornerstone upon which their entire faith is understood and the lens through which they understand human experience. And it's very easy, if you hold that point of view, to understand any natural disaster as something being visited by the Creator who is expressing his or its displeasure with you. Thus it was among the ancient Greeks, thus it is among many commentators even today, who will leap in front of a TV camera or on the radio, and now of course in social media, and perpetrate this awful theology, which unfortunately is often taught and is transmitted from generation to generation. In contrast to that notion that sinfulness is at the root of humanity, is another tradition that speaks of the inherent worth and dignity of every person, that speaks of nature as being an indifferent force. But within this indifferent universe is life. One of the turning points in my spiritual journey was to discover Albert Schweitzer and to discover how his notion of spirituality evolved, and he claimed the title of humanist, but understood that to be a human being and to cultivate spirituality, you had to have compassion not just for your own pitiful state of suffering, not just those of your particular tribe, but of all humanity, and then some. Not just the human species, but all that lives and breathes. And to have a compassion that encompasses all animal life. And I thought, interesting. And it was initially an intellectual aha moment. But then I began to consider how other human beings, other religions encountered animals. Now, every year now, of course, we have a blessing of the animals, minus the animals because of my allergies. But as we heard today, and as I've heard repeatedly throughout my adult life, how animals, be they pets or others, can become family, and we understand that the divisions we make between what it is a human being and what is just another animal, how those are in many instances arbitrary. Perhaps the humanist spirituality, which is evolving, will continue to move in that direction. Now, do we depend upon certain forms of animals for protein and for life? Yes, we do. Is that the best option open to us? To be debated, to be discussed, as we continue to wrestle with this, and perhaps as our spirituality continues to move further along that path. Now, in the last 20 years, there have been a whole host of new atheists: Christopher Hitchens, Sam Harris, Richard Dawkins, Daniel Dennett, who have proposed much more of what is an academic understanding of what it means to be a person who lives his or her life without a traditional faith. And when I have read their works, I'm reminded of the various straw men that I myself built and the caricatures of religion and belief that I found so easy to dispose of. I have seen them on television, I've heard their arguments, I have seen a backlash from so-called people of faith who attack them and their ideas and denounce them. And I realize how easy it is to walk that particular path, to taunt people, to prick their beliefs, and to goad them into a reaction, the result of which you can sell more books. I would hope that as we continue to wrestle with what it means to be a religious humanist as opposed to a secular humanist, what it means to be a non-theist, an agnostic, as opposed to an atheist or secular humanist, that we will begin to have a broader sense of compassion for those whose ideas and beliefs we find distasteful. Now, even in our own tradition, this Unitarian Universalism, you can often find residue of a bygone era where people insisted that it's deeds and not creeds upon which we build our spirituality. Now, you can look at that and you can dissect it one of two ways. You can say it is how a person lives her life, what they encounter, what informs their life, and how they respond to the circumstances into which they have been born and into which they grow as a human being. Or you could take the opposite, more antagonistic position and say all creeds are worthless, that they are the product of a Bronze Age mentality, and the sooner they are discarded, the better. I find that there are certain individuals who are humanist and very spiritual, provide an interesting pathway to work through one's mindset and the various options available to us. And I find that John Shelby Spong is a fascinating person to turn one's attention to. A Christian bishop, retired. Someone who understands metaphor and allegory and understands that scripture is never perfect, that in fact it is often imperfect, and that some of the teachings are immoral. But to try to separate the wheat from the chaff, to use that old metaphor, and to construct an informed spirituality based on a particular tradition, but the best thereof, and not everything. And I think that that approach to spirituality appeals to most of the people in our movement, certainly in this room. And I would invoke again the sense that many of us are heretics, in the sense that the word heresy means to pick and to choose, to weigh and to select certain kernels of truth, be it in our own life, or in the scriptures of the ages, or in poetry, astronomy, the sciences, and to construct a new understanding of ourselves and this universe and all that it encompasses as best as we can imagine. Turning again to some of my mentors, known and unknown. I think that a humanist spirituality requires a deep sense of poetry, of wonder, of appreciation that we're not going to understand everything, we're not going to have a ready answer for everything, that our answers will continue to change as our understandings change. That the basis of our religion will be founded on natural sciences as well, but open to mystery and wonder from other sources. That it will include a strong sense of humility, something with which I have been learning. It will also, in its best form, include humor. One of my favorite quips, you will recognize perhaps the source, is an individual who will say, "I'm an atheist, thank God." But also learn to laugh at themselves and not take oneself too seriously. But above all, I think the richest prospect for this new evolving humanist spirituality will be the sense of compassion. And this, of course, is not unique to this tradition. In fact, the finest strand of any religion that I have ever encountered, and there's many of them, lift up compassion, cultivate compassion, grow a soul to understand yourself as part of this unfolding universe that is struggling and suffering. I'd like to share one particular excerpt from a book entitled The Blue Dot, written by Carl Sagan, which I think captures the essence of this new evolving humanism. Speaking of a photograph of the solar system in which there are waves of different colors, stripes, and in one particular minute part of that photograph is a blue dot, you really need someone to draw your attention to it and say, "This dot here." He says, "Look again at that dot. That's here. That's home. That's us. On it, everyone you love, everyone you know, everyone you ever heard of, every human being, whoever was, lived out their lives. The aggregate of our joy and suffering, thousands of confident religions, ideologies, and economic doctrines, every hunter and forager, every hero and coward, every creator and destroyer of civilization, every king and every peasant, every young couple in love, every mother and father, hopeful child, inventor, explorer, every teacher of morals, every corrupt politician, every superstar, every supreme leader, every saint and sinner in the history of our species has lived here on a mote of dust suspended in a sunbeam. The Earth, Sagan says, is a very small stage in a vast cosmic arena. Think of the rivers of blood spilled by all those generals and emperors so that in glory and in triumph, they could become the momentary masters of a fraction of a dot. Think of the endless cruelties visited by the inhabitants of one corner of this pixel upon the scarcely distinguishable inhabitants of some other corner. How frequent their misunderstandings, how eager they are to kill one another, how fervent their hatred. Our posturings, our imagined self-importance, the delusion that we have some privileged position in this universe are challenged by this point of pale light. Our planet is a lonely speck in the great enveloping cosmic dark. In our obscurity, in all this vastness, there is no hint that help will come from elsewhere to save us from ourselves. The Earth is the only known world so far known to harbor life. There is nowhere else, at least in the near future, to which our species could migrate. Visit, perhaps. Settle, not yet. Like it or not, for the moment, the Earth is where we will make our stand. It has been said that astronomy is a humbling and character-building experience. There is perhaps no better demonstration of the folly of human conceits than this distant image of our tiny world. To me, it underscores our responsibility to deal more kindly with one another and to preserve and to cherish the pale blue dot, the only home we've ever known. With those words, with that scripture, I commend to you to be seekers with grace, with humility, with responsibility, and above all, with compassion. May we journey further and explore more the various corners of this pale blue dot we call home. Amen and blessed be. For our closing words, I commend you this sentiment by Theodore Parker, a 19th century Unitarian minister who was a great inspiration to Abraham Lincoln. Be ours a religion which, like sunshine, goes everywhere. Its temple, all space. Its shrine, the good heart. Its creed, all truth. Its ritual, works of love. Its profession of faith, divine living.